enjoying the sweet, juicy sugar cane as the cane is milled are children of the great oasis along the Nile. Stretching westward from the long Nile River Valley oasis is the great Sahara Desert. But in this sandy wasteland, there are other fertile places where water is found. These oases are smaller than the large Nile oasis. Camels, which may go a long time without drinking, can get some water from sparse desert plants. Camels form caravans, which cross the desert bringing supplies to the oases and carrying crops to the cities. Occasionally, when crossing the hot, dry desert, men may see what appears to be the image of a lake in the desert. This is an actual picture of such an image called a mirage. Although the water of a mirage is not real, date palm trees and houses of mud are sure signs of an oasis, a center of life and water in the desert. The majestic date palms grow well here, their roots extending far down into the sandy soil to reach the water deep underground. The fruit of these trees, sweet sun-ripened dates, is harvested by the people of the oasis and is one of the chief crops of this desert community. Like every other living thing here, the date palms owe their lives to the waters of the oasis. From all parts of the village, from the narrow dusty streets, on camels, and on foot, the people come to the spring for the precious water. Some of the water is used to moisten the soil to make mud, which is placed into moulds. The moulds are removed and the bricks dry in the sun. Such mud bricks are used to make the village buildings. Water for household use is carried by women and girls in jugs made of baked clay. Although the village children must do their share of work, there's still time for school. The teacher in this open-air school instructs his class in Arabic, the language of the people of Egypt. While the children are in school, the older people of the village relax and talk about village affairs. They may talk of wind and sand, two great enemies of oasis peoples. The desert winds are sometimes very strong, and fences have been built all around the oasis to prevent sand from covering it completely. Even so, the sand continues to drift, and someday the people may have to leave their homes, as happened in this oasis village, which is now deserted. For past generations, the search for a new oasis meant a long, difficult journey across the desert sands, for there were few places where natural sources of water could be found. But today, the desert people are being helped in their search for water. From Cairo, teams of government engineers are being sent out to survey the desert. They search for trees or other plants which may indicate water. Having found water, the engineers test it to make sure that it's fresh and pure. If the water is good, the well will be the center of a new village in the midst of the barren desert. The new settlers will irrigate the land with the water bubbling up from this new well. Sometimes the well must be drilled and the water lifted by the simple methods of the fellaheen, as the peasants are called. Such methods may be wasteful and time-consuming, but slowly and steadily the job of bringing the water from the well goes on. Other fellaheen dig irrigation ditches through the sandy soil. The most exciting moment of all is when water begins to run through the irrigation ditches. Water for fields that have never produced crops, but which will now provide food for an entire village. And still the search for water continues in the desert. Careful planning, up-to-date equipment, and modern skills make deeper wells possible, and so create new oases. Modern drills are supported in great towers and are mechanically operated. Generally, such deep wells produce an abundance of water. But bringing the water to the surface is only the first step towards building an oasis. Water must be put to work. Huge bulldozers are brought in to turn and break up the arid desert ground. This land, which has been barren for thousands of years, is extremely dry and hard. The broken ground is leveled and then flooded with the newly discovered water to remove unwanted salts so that crops will grow. After a year, the flooded earth is allowed to dry out and then it is turned over again. Carefully, the workers guide the powerful machines over the many acres that will form the fields of the new oasis. Thousands of tons of soil are turned, spread and leveled in this large government operation that will provide homes for dozens of families. Once the fields have been properly prepared, the engineers supervise the next step of the project, digging irrigation ditches. The main canals must be deep in order to carry enough water for crops. Fertilizer for crops may come from this large fertilizer factory being built near the Nile. Much of the fertilizer produced here may be used on new farmlands, such as those being created by the new irrigation developments along the Nile River. Engineers have worked out a plan for building a new dam across the Nile near the town of Aswan. The purpose of the new dam is to control floods, to provide water power, and to store water that can be pumped to fields miles away from the river. In the future, more aqueducts will be used to carry water to the fields. By simply turning a valve, the water is released to flow down into irrigation ditches in green fields. Green fields, which were once part of the desert. The precious water has brought life to the wasteland. New crops to feed the people and new land where they can work and live. Let's remember that these fields, these stalks of grain, are part of a man-made oasis, one of the many oases now being established in desert lands. These are adding to the agricultural wealth of natural oases where date palms and a few other crops can be grown with available water. In the new oases, with the help of modern science, a greater variety of crops can be grown by the desert people. Gradually, it may be transformed into vast farmlands, whose produce will make possible healthier and better lives.